So in the previous video, we covered the motivation behind data loaders. And in this video, we are going to dive into the nitty-gritty details of how we implement data loaders and datasets in PyTorch. So in particular, we are going to see how datasets and data loaders work together. So there are mainly four steps to implementing our data loading pipeline here. So first, we will create a dataset class, and then in the second step, we will instantiate dataset objects from this dataset class. In step 3, we will then instantiate data loaders based on the datasets. And in step 4, we will then take our data loaders to a test drive to make sure they work before we actually use them for our model training. Yeah, let's now walk through the data loading pipeline step by step, starting with step 1, creating a custom dataset class. So the dataset class needs to define how the data is loaded, and it has to have a getItem method here. So this is a specific or special method in the context of dataset classes, and we will see how we implement this getItem method in a few moments. So here's the code outline of a custom dataset class, and yeah, at first glance, it might look a bit intimidating. However, there are only, let's say, three main concepts to remember here. So first, we have the init method. And in Python, when we have an init method, this one gets executed when we instantiate new objects from that class. So here, for this init method for the dataset class, what we do is we define certain variables or paths, file paths, that we are going to use in the other methods. So don't worry too much about the nitty-gritty details of this code section here. We will dive through that in the hands-on coding examples in the next video. However, one thing to note is that here, in this specific case, we implement a dataset class for loading images. So here we have a CSV file with the class labels and the image folders that we assign to variables here so that we can use them in the other methods in this dataset class. So all you need to remember for now is that in the init method, we set up our attributes that we want to use in the getItem method. So the getItem method is a specific method of the dataset class that defines how we load a single training record. So in this case, you can see that getItem method returns an image and the corresponding label. So this is really our training set pair. We have img as a placeholder for the image, and then the label variable as the placeholder for the corresponding class label. So all you need to remember here is that the getItem method is the way we define how a data point is loaded. So lastly, we have this length method, where here we define how long our dataset is. And here we are getting that length from the labels vector that we initialized in the init method. But yeah, how you get exactly the length of the data, that's really up to the specific data set and how you implement the init method. In this case, we are loading a data array where we store all the labels. And the total number of labels would then equal the size of our data set. All right, let's now assume we created our dataset class. And the next step, step 2, is instantiating the datasets. In the typical deep learning project, we have at least 3 datasets: the training dataset, the validation dataset, and the test dataset. Again, as you can see, the code for these 3 datasets is almost identical, except that the file paths are a bit different. So of course, for the training dataset, we use a different label array than for the validation set and the test set. And of course, the images for training and validation are also stored in different locations. Again, if this looks complicated, don't be intimidated. We will have a hands-on coding video where we will walk through these steps with a very concrete dataset. So for now, note that we also have the transform argument here, which defines the dataset transformation that we need to go from an image from our computer into a PyTorch tensor that the model can work with. But again, this is something we will see in the hands-on coding video. So in step 1, we created our dataset class. Now in step 2, we then instantiated the dataset objects. In step 3, we are going to instantiate the data loaders based on these datasets we just created in step 2. And this is also the step where we define the data shuffling, the batch size, and the number of processes that we want to use to load the data. So here's the code of how this looks like. So if we have 3 datasets, we also want to have 3 data loaders, of course. We are going to use the data loader class here from PyTorch, and we are providing as input the datasets that we just created. That's of course the train dataset, the validation dataset, and the test dataset. So these are the dataset instances that we instantiated in step 2. So after completing these 3 steps, we now have a data loader for the training, validation, and test set. But before letting these data loaders loose on the model, I personally recommend testing them out because there are a lot of things that can go wrong. And by inspecting the return features and labels, we can sometimes spot errors that are harder to debug later when we train the model. So personally, what I usually do is I set up a model training loop without the actual model training. So here I'm just printing out the values returned by the data loader. So what I'm particularly curious about here is to make sure that the batch size is the expected batch size and that the data, the features, have the expected shape. So here we have a data loader that loads images, and so we are having a batch size of 32 and one color channel, and then an image of size 28 times 28, which is as expected. So if these numbers look confusing, we will see why the size is exactly like that in the hands-on coding video. And maybe the most important thing to look out for here is if the labels are loaded correctly and are shuffled correctly. Sometimes it can happen, for example, that you have only labels from one particular class, which would of course not be ideal. So here, this is a great way of checking whether the labels are indeed shuffled. So yeah, but this is just a quick sanity check. It's just to make sure that the data loaders look like as we expect and that there's no unwanted surprise here. Yeah, but before we end this video, I also wanted to mention the new composable data pipes. So data pipes are a replacement for the original dataset class. Personally, I find using the dataset class is a little bit more, let's say, intuitive or familiar. However, some people also prefer data pipes when building more complicated data loading pipelines. I consider data pipes as a new and advanced feature, so you don't have to worry about it yet. So I will actually share a few resources with you in an article I've wrote comparing datasets with data pipes if you find that helpful. So yeah, in this video we covered the basics behind implementing datasets and data loaders on a conceptual level with a few code examples. In the next video we will have a hands-on coding video where I will show you how these things work on a concrete dataset.